George Martin instructed everyone who worked in that studio during the entire process from 63 on, said, do not throw anything away. Keep every last little bit. All right. Alex Huard.
More Beatles.
Here we are. More Beatles. More Beatles.
Beatles.
Have you had enough Beatles?
I don't know. I think there are a lot of Beatles, right? There's quite a bit of Beatles.
Yep. A lot of Beatles. So this is the fourth Beatles record. I kind of feel, I was thinking about this today, I kind
like
of
we should
feel,
get to the music.
Yeah, let's just get right to it. No.
Yeah, what do you kind of feel? You kind of feel?
I kind of feel like it's a lot, but it's a story that has to be told in this way.
You really see friggin' what, like, the music they made, man. Just like that's all I can say. The music they made,
right?
It just did, I just went so unappreciated by me for so long. Oh yeah.
But again, that is the whole purpose of this show.
Right? Yeah, yeah. It is just, man. I mean, I can see why it could be tough for younger people to get into this stuff. So I get it. I don't like discredit myself. I mean, we've talked about there being, you know, people just being ahead of the curve, right? People who, you know, were just into people like Bruce Springsteen when they were young, you know, just not, this wasn't you and I, right? No. I mean, I don't know. When did you start getting into the Beatles?
The White Album, 1990. So I was 20 years old.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
I missed it. Like, I mean, people, I don't know if anybody in my proximity socially listened to the Beatles when I was a kid, other than like, you know, like older people. So I wouldn't have been into it, right? But like I hit it when I was 20. But then I didn't really get into it until I was in my 30s. I liked the White Album, but I didn't really kind of dig in, you know. I knew
and
all
start
the songs.
Listening. Right. And like start listening like it meant something, right?
Critically and intimately, right? Yeah.
Yeah, just the kind of taste in music you would have had to have or where you just had to be mentally for music or if you heard it in 1969, you know, when you were experiencing it for the first time, right? Like that I can get, but I just feel like it's such a it just took time and I could see why it would take time. Other than songs like, what are we thinking here? Octopus's Garden from this one, or Yellow Submarine. Right. From Revolver, right? Or Obladi Oblada, right? Some fun, more, you know, or Bungalow Bill, right? Kind of kiddie songs that kids would want to get into.
Right.
Right. Outside of that, it's very, very sophisticated stuff.
Well, this album in particular is super sophisticated in my you know, opinion. And I had told you, if you think back to Revolver, I said that it was regarded probably now as like the Beatles' best album, if you can even say that of any of these. But Abbey Road, you could make a case. This is a damn good record.
A lot of people really love this album, eh?
It's a funny thing to me because, you know, I was listening to it again before the show. And when you go through side one, you go through, you know, come together in something right there just like blows the whole roof off the place, like right off the bat.
Yeah.
Right? In terms of like sophistication and quality. But then the medley, and we'll get into these, but the medley was almost just a cast off. It was almost like, here's just our scraps.
Right. You know?
But
that's wild, eh?
Really? Like Lennon said that in an interview, I think, that he did later. He said it was junk. He said it was just a bunch of junk that we had odds and sods of, and we just kind of put them together.
You know, like I said in the last episode, Paul and I have a lot in common, and I've got a ton of songs that remind me of this medley that I call just junk. So maybe I'll release it at some point. But
you should.
Like, that is so insane. Like, this is that was the Beatles' junk. Wild. Okay, I do want to get into this real quick before we do. Did you do our little homework task?
Of course I did.
Yeah, okay. All right. Of course. He pulls out his phone and quickly types the top 10. Folks.
No. I actually took it. I've got it right here.
Remember what we said last week, last episode, was we were going to take all the songs from the White Album and make a 10-song record. And our favorite songs that we feel could make up the best 10-song, one album, White Album. So who wants to go first? Do you want me to go first?
Yeah, you go first. Sure.
Me go first? Okay. Yeah. All right. Here we go. So I'm just going to fire through them. Okay. Yeah. You just fire through them. I'll just go. Okay. I'll do it. All right. Here we go.
Is it 10 only?
Okay. Maybe I have two extra bonus tracks on here just in case.
I knew you were going to do that.
But did you do it?
11.
11? Okay.
See? You can't just do 10.
It's tough. It is tough. So here we go. Okay. So Back in the USSR, Bungalow Bill, Happiness is a Warm Gun, Martha, My Dear, Blackbird,
Good.
Glass Onion, Rocky Raccoon, Mother Nature's Son, Savoy Truffle, Good Night.
Wow.
10. Those are 10. My additional two, if I could have made it a 12-song album, which is a stipulation we did not tell the rest of the audience, so come at us. Don't Pass Me By, and Everybody's Got Something to Hide. Yeah.
Don't Pass Me By. Really, eh?
Hey.
No judgment.
That's why there's just okay. All right. So what do you got? What are your 10?
That's right. So 11. My record will be right beside yours in the record store. Okay. We'll see who buys which one. I'm just joking.
All right. Okay.
So Dear Prudence, Bungalow Bill, Glass Onion, Happiness is a Warm Gun, Martha, My Dear, I'm So Tired, Blackbird, Julia, Mother Nature's Son, Sexy Sadie, and bonus track, Cry Baby Cry.
Wow. Look at that. Interesting.
I could not go down to 10. I Glass Onion, I was like, no.
I'll tell you what, it was between Glass Onion and Piggies for me. I wanted to bring Piggies somewhere on this one, but Glass Onion for me took it. I feel like having a Rocky Raccoon and a Piggies. But yeah. How did you do it? Did you stew, or did you kind of look at it and go, and just, you were just like,
no, man,
when I see these songs, it's
funny because it was easier than I thought. And I remarked at that. I'm like, wow, that this is going to be a lot harder than it is. But then I got down to that last bit and I was like, I love Cry Baby Cry. And I thought, I got to have it on here. And so I went back and I thought, should I take Glass Onion off? But then I thought, no, I can't do that. So, yeah, I stewed for a little while, but, the first 5 minutes I had like all 11 songs.
Nice.
Yeah.
Good.
And that's not to say there aren't, like, I enjoy most of the whole record. Like, you know, the songs I don't particularly like, I mean, I think there's only like, three or four of them. You know, and to clarify, if, there's a person who commented on the show and I said there was some Drek, that person said, Drek, really? And we had a funny exchange. I love the record, right? There's going to be clunkers. There's 30 bloody songs.
The album,
there's
going to
be a couple that not everybody loves. So,
and like you said too, right? It's like you couldn't imagine the album without these songs, right? It's like, it's Drek, but it's like, it kind of is all that makes up what the album is.
The ethos of the record is great because it's just a huge kind of amalgam of everything that was going on artistically for the band.
Yeah.
Put it that way, you know? And that's what I recognize, and I appreciate that.
So the album was very much the Beatles owning it as the Beatles only could.
Mm-hmm.
And for Abbey Road, they brought back their fearless producer and George Martin. She's so...
And Jeff Emmerich is back too.
That's right. They came back, and it was only because Paul and John and Ringo and George said, let's do it like the old days, fellas.
That's right. There was a focus on that, right? There was a focus of like, remember when we used to play? Look at those guys. Remember when we used to play, you know, sharp dressed men.
27
years old, I think. Paul was. Yeah. I don't know how old the other guys were. I think Lennon might have been
passed out
older.
On a basement floor somewhere when I was 27. That was pretty well approaching Beatles status. God, yeah. 27. Great. That's awesome. Good stuff.
What a record, eh?
It's a good album, man. It's a lot of these albums, these Beatles albums have taken me time to get into. This has never been a turn it on and settle right in and really love the Beatles. Each one of these albums have taken me time and some patience to really get into.
But this is such a sophisticated record for me. It's different from Revolver because you really, I can't say the quality of the songs, but just the sophistication of them. Like I Want You, She's So Heavy, for example. So that keep in mind, it was the White Album, and then it was this little number here, Yellow Submarine, came out. But it was, again, it was just like this. A lot of this stuff was going on, right?
That didn't come out between Revolver and White Album, or that came after White Album?
Technically, it came before Let It Be, or before Abbey Road and after the White Album. Because I think it was just based on like a little...
Right.
Movie, right? Called Yellow Submarine. But you wouldn't know any of the songs. Like they're called like Pepperland. And there's a song called Hey Bulldog you might know. All Together Now, maybe. But it doesn't, in my opinion, it doesn't really count as a Beatles record. It is, but it's a cast off. Yeah. And then Alex, Let It Be was released after. But it was, again, part of a movie. And so what happened was they started to record this for the movie. The whole thing fell apart because the idea for the movie and the infrastructure and everything just kind of like came apart. And so they shelved it. And Abbey Road was started and finished before they could, you know, kind of really sink their teeth in with Let It Be. So this is regarded as the last proper like technical record, and then this came out later on. It was cobbled together, and John had already left the band, by the way, by this time
when Let It Be came out.
Wow. Although no one really knew that until Paul said he was quitting, and then it was just a big Lennon had been gone already.
Well, that's you know, obviously unfortunate. We know history. We know musical history. We know what happened to the Beatles. But you know, when you listen to the songs and the music up to this point, you're like, man, it's like the end of Van Halen, right? I mean, maybe not as powerful. Maybe I'll get some heat for that comment. But you know, when Van Halen breaks up, you're like, wow, why? What the heck?
I know.
You guys are so good. You guys are so good.
That's the thing. Like they offered, you know, a little clue with the Diver Down album cover and all that stuff. And I think there was a little bit of, well, there was chirping with the Beatles too. I mean, you know, people were saying Harrison was pretty vocal. He said, you know, I wasn't really into being fab anymore.
Right.
And even for this record, I think he said something like, you could sense that it felt like the end was coming. I can't remember his direct quote, but he said it felt like the end was approaching. And so, you know, Lennon was already gone. And for this record, actually, it's kind of funny because, you know, there's some collaborations and some nice moments. But Lennon said, you know, I want to break up the Lennon-McCartney thing because they had agreed, depending on who wrote what, or it didn't matter who wrote what, it would always be titled Lennon-McCartney Composition for royalties. But Lennon, for the first time in the history of the Beatles, said, I want all of my songs on one side of the record, and I want all of Paul's songs on the other side of the record. And everybody, including Martin, was like, no, we can't do that. And he said, no, that's what I want. So yeah, there was a lot of, there was division
is this where they felt like, was this Yoko's doing? Was it like, you know, her telling John potentially that he's just not getting the respect or, you know, the what he deserves or the music he deserves? Like, because this album feels very Paul centric. Like, I think that there's quite a few Lennon tunes on here, but it just feels very much, especially that whole second side, feels like it's just like Paul McCartney everywhere.
It's funny that you say that, because when I put it on, Come Together is John right off the bat. And then, interestingly, it's George Harrison, right?
Yeah.
With Something. And then the first song that McCartney offers up, talk about like tune stack recognition, is a goofy song called Maxwell Silver Hammer, right? So you think, like, really, Paul? Like, where are you?
Yeah.
So it's not like a long and winding road or a, you know, a substantial song, which I thought that he would be like right, you know, in front saying, kind of, here I am. So right. this kind of feels more like a Lennon record to me.
Maybe the first half. I feel maybe that's what it is. And I feel like because the back half just feels so like McCartney melodies in my brief, you know, 6 weeks of listening to the Beatles. Well,
that's the thing. I mean, right? Yeah.
But it was just everything about how the second half plays out. I want to talk about that.
I'm way ahead of you just because I read books like this, right?
Wow.
So like The Beatles and 100 Objects. On the back of this book, so the book basically is about like 100 objects that have to do with the Beatles, like the cars they drove, the instruments, the clothes they wore. And there's a quote on the back from Lennon's Aunt Mimi. That was she took custody of him after his mom passed away. And the quote is, "That guitar is okay, John, but you'll never make a living with it." Isn't that funny?
Great. Thanks, Aunt Mimi.
Proved you wrong. Okay.
Okay, last thing before we get into this, I know people are probably just get into it.
Come on, man.
Yeah.
There's a reason why these bloody shows are so long.
Just thinking about all the additional pieces for the Beatles. There's like the White Album, which is long, but there's still like the extended edition. There's the Abbey Road, but there's the extended edition. There's Get Back. They have all of these things documenting this band. The only thing I just wanted to say about this is it's like, I feel like that's how you know when the bands are like the greatest bands, is when they have all of these things recorded, from outtakes to extra takes to, you know, what in this one, I think when they were recording She's So Heavy, the police came and they caught that on audio. And then, so when I think about that and everything they have with them, then I also think about Springsteen. Springsteen has a million records, a million live records, extras, outtakes, things like that. Tom Petty, same thing. Great documentaries, great extra pieces. Like, I just feel like these bands that are like known as the best or like the greatest or have just such a great library of everything, because they were like, we need to capture everything because this is great. Just want to make that point.
In the case of the Beatles, George Martin was solely responsible for that.
Wow.
And we'll talk about that. There's an excellent story, you know, that I'll tell at the very end of the episode when we talk about Her Majesty.
Okay.
But George Martin instructed everyone who worked in that studio during the entire process from 63 on, said, do not throw anything away. Keep every last little bit. And thank God that he did, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, crazy. That was his. Crazy. He was very serious about that. So
yeah, that's cool. They just caught they just caught everything, right? They just caught everything in those moments, and fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
Just love how everything can come together.
Good kickoff for the record.
Wasn't that something?
It really was. Were you building up to that? Very impressive.
Thank you. Come Together. Here we go. Let's do it. Let's get into it.
Great song. So this is obviously John, but it's about him. You know, it's kind of loosely based on like his And people said that he kind of was writing about himself as this kind of pariah now, that he was like almost a victim in his band. And, you know, he's like this kind of, you know, and the song's about him, but there's a line that goes, Spinal Cracker. That's Yoko, apparently. Spinal Cracker. So, yeah, so the song is basically about, like, you know, it's a character, and the character is John.
It's him, yeah.
Accompanied by Yoko, yeah.
See, people were talking about it maybe being like each verse was about a Beatle or something like that. That was another theory. And when so I read it and I looked at it, I was like, I think each one of these is about John. Like, I did not get that they would think anything about any other Beatle in these verses, but...
People, there's so many interpretations, right? And so many perspectives. Like somebody said, Juju Eyeball is Dr. John, who was like a popular figure, popular musical artist back then. And people they associated with, but like, I don't know. Like, I mean, I have no idea.
Yeah.
I would assume the song's about John, but whatever.
Like, yeah. And John just, I'm pretty sure he just said it was just kind of like gobbledygook, right? That was one of his quotes.
Yeah.
It was just stuff that I came with in the studio.
Yeah. He was good. He and Paul were, I guess all the Beatles were great like that. They really kind of told you, like, you know, there wasn't any, they didn't keep their cards close to their chest, right? They said, this was just stupid. Like, this is a joke. We're goofing off and this is what we came up with. It wasn't like, well, you know, we were inspired by,
right?
You know.
Yeah, they did a lot of drugs, a lot of meditation, but
yeah,
this was just stuff off the top of their head, I guess, right?
Absolutely.
Saying things.
And that's great because a lot of it is just that. Like, it's just loose goofiness. And it's like, it's this, you know?
Yeah.
Just, oh man.
Yeah. It's pretty good. It's a pretty good song. I've heard it a lot. It's okay. Like, a lot of people love this song. Like, again, just in what I've understood and reading and listening, like, some people, like, I don't know. I'm not one of those people. I don't love this song. It's cool. It's okay. But, yeah. All I have are sound effects. It's not special to me. Come at me, people. Come at me. Come together. Something.
Right.
Also subpar for a little bit. Yeah. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, it's okay. It's okay.
Oh, man.
I know. Like, hey, I'll take the stick. It's okay. It's.
Wow.
Great, some great moments. I love how it changes. It's a nice love song, but
Wow.
Yeah.
So you know what's funny about it? It's like I was ready to give George Harrison's a big props here. This is probably the best song that he's ever written, in my opinion.
You know, like I'm not thinking anything. Yeah, but okay, but. I hate to do it. I hate to say why and put you on the spot, but why? Like, why do people love the song so much from him?
Like, it's very, again, we're using the word sophisticated a lot, but
yeah, it is.
Compositionally, it's just great. That ending guitar line, the melody is just perfect. It's almost up there with something that McCartney would write. And I just thought that after, you know, Harrison had written some songs and, We've established on previous shows that I don't hate him, but I don't, you know. He really kind of hit it out of the park with this song. I thought it was great. But, you know, there's a funny story about this song that Sinatra was talking to somebody about the Beatles. And he said, you know, my favorite Beatles or my favorite Lennon McCartney composition is Something. It's a Something. Beautiful love song.
Yeah.
And they're like, it was George Harris.
George Harris.
Oh, it's my favorite Lennon McCartney song. So, like, dude just could not catch a break.
No kidding.
Best song of his career. People think it's a Lennon McCartney song.
Yeah, I guess he wrote it thinking of Ray Charles or thinking of Ray Charles being able to sing it or singing it like this. And
I don't know.
He said that, it was like Ray Charles came to mind for him with this one. And he said, he's like, you know, I like the James Brown version, and there's another version he said he likes, but I'm not really a big fan of the Frank Sinatra version. It's like, well, of course you're not. He said, you know, he said it was a Lennon McCartney song. So, that's yeah, true. Look, I'm not taking away from, like, I think it is very sophisticated, and maybe this is showing where I'm just like, I haven't fully grown the Beatles, but it's a beautiful song. It is. It just doesn't, I don't know, it doesn't hit me the way that, like, some people talk about it, or the way it's spoken of. So I don't know. I don't know.
Yeah.
Just for now. Come back to it in 10 years.
Supertramp. We'll come back to it later.
Oh, God.
Alice Cooper.
Yeah. Maybe when I'm 99 and I can't hear anymore, we can do Supertramp.
When you're 64.
Oh,
thank when you. When you're 64. Yeah. There is a Lennon piano line on the song that was stripped off at the last minute. But you can still hear it if you listen closely.
No kidding. What's that? Where is that?
I think it's right before one of the choruses. You can hear Lennon's piano in the background.
But crank it up.
It was on there. They took it off, but they left it. There's a little bit on that's still on if you listen.
Interesting. Yeah, it's funny. You know, we mentioned that too. They talked about what Harrison playing the guitar solo on this, but he wanted to play it live, and they and it was dangerous because of all the orchestra sounds in the background. So we had like one take to get it, something like that, or something like that.
Something. Wow, you're good with the.
I got them.
What about Abbey Road? I was waiting for your big.
Yeah.
What happened to that little game?
Well, if we have the episode's not over yet.
Well, you're supposed to do it before we start talking about the record.
God damn it. You're right.
I just want to start over.
Yeah, can we start from the top? Brent, what's up, man?
Hey, yeah, all right.
You want to know what rhymes with flabby toad?
What?
Abbey Road. Okay. Maxwell's Silverhammer. Wow.
We've reached a new low on Thursday Night Record Club.
I did folks. It, folks. I brought it in. I brought it in, and you didn't see it coming. So
I didn't see that coming at all. No. No.
You check mark. Oh, God. Maxwell Silverhammer. So tell me, was there anything else about something? Or you... No. Maxwell Silverhammer. So you're not a fan. You're like, what the hell is he doing here?
I think the song is funny. I think it's clever. I love the lyrics. Another song I used to play on guitar because I thought it was hilarious at university. But not anything that you'd ever take seriously. And you know who really, really hated the song?
The Beatles.
John Lennon.
Yeah.
Hated this particular. He refused to play on it.
Right. Didn't do a thing.
Yeah. It was written in India, so it was supposed to be on the White Album, and the rest of the Beatles rejected it because it was too complex. They thought it was too complicated and didn't want to be a part of it, and it just got shelved.
Yeah.
Lennon never did play on it because he called it granny music, and he came in, they were playing it, and he said, oh, more of Paul's granny music, and he left.
It's funny. You're right. It's funny lyrics, but that's about it. It's okay. Oh, darling.
That should have been next.
That should have been number three.
Yeah. That's a nice little McCartney composition.
It was a great song.
Yeah. I like it a lot.
Yeah.
McCartney wanted a rasp on his voice for this. So he would, this is kind of cool. He came in like once a day and he tried the vocal. And if he didn't like it, he left it. But he said to somebody said, like, what are you doing that for? And he said, I want it to be really rough and ragged. And if it's not, I don't want to continue with it. I want it to sound like I've been playing the song all week. I don't know why, but that's what he wanted. And apparently Lennon wanted to sing this song too. But
yeah, he really wanted it on it. Felt like Paul wasn't the right fit.
Mm-hmm.
And they broke up. Yeah, it's yeah. I mean, when he gets into the "when you told me," like, I don't know, like, could John really have, like, I don't know. Paul sounds great there.
I don't know. Maybe Paul. People are gonna freak out. I kind of feel like Paul had more of that, like, Ray Charles-y kind of bluesy, you know, style. Lennon had the angry rock kind of, you know, but I don't know. I don't think that who knows? I'd love to hear. I wish that, you know, that would be something that wasn't thrown away. If Lennon just did it on his own and put it in a vault somewhere, that would be very, very interesting to listen to.
Octopus is Garden like was what they say was the second Ringo Starr song. Yeah. No, the second song that he wrote. Like, think about Octopus is Garden being the second song you ever write, folks. Right.
After the first one was?
Yeah, don't pass me by. Right. Yeah. Awesome. Great song. See, I'm a Ringo fan, man. I love his tunes. You think about this song, it's just so fun. Like, it's nice and quirky and just escapist, and it has great moments as well. It's this boppy thing, and then it gets into this minor moment. It's such a good song. I love the song.
Good.
Somebody what about has you? To. Yeah.
No, I don't know. I can't lie and say that I do. I mean, again, don't hate it. I appreciate the art. He had written this on Peter Sellers' yacht, apparently, during his little absence from the Beatles during the White Album. After he left for 3 weeks, remember? So he went on Peter Sellers' yacht, and apparently was looking out on the water and kind of came up with this.
Well, I just finished writing a song on Ryan Gosling's boat, actually. So
yeah, what's it called?
Just take your time, man. I'm just gonna it'll come out. It'll come out when it's ready. What's it called?
Yeah.
Get out of here, man. What are you trying to do?
You don't want
to leak
share
the info about my the song I wrote on Ryan Gosling's yacht. No way. Yeah, he got a piece of squid instead of a piece of instead of. What did he ask for? I think he ordered chicken, but he got a piece of squid instead.
Oh.
And then that's when I think Peter Sellers told him all about octopuses and where they lived and how they traveled on the ocean bed and would pick up little pieces and make a garden out of rocks and stuff like that. So,
oh.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. See? Look at that.
Kind of fun. I Want You, She's So Heavy. You're a big fan of this one.
Love this song.
Wow. Love this song.
There is, it's like a lounge jazz ish, the just to be able to compose this and record it the way, you know, I don't know. This is one of those songs that just really blows me away.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Not for you, eh?
It's cool. It's not bad. It's, kind of sounds like Oh Darling a little bit, like the guitar riff, like before it it gets into I want you so bad. Mm-hmm. It's got a little bit of Oh Darling to it. Otherwise, it's okay. It's cool. I know that he got hated on by Rolling Stones magazine that said that he was losing his lyrical ability because of how simple the song is.
Yeah. He was asked about that, I think, and he said that that was his intention. He wanted it. He wanted the music to speak. He didn't really care about the lyrics because obviously it was about Yoko, so it wasn't his concern. He just wanted. He was thinking about the musicality of it.
This song goes on this gigantic rant of a outro, instrumental outro, and then it does the just cuts, right? Famous just cuts right at the end of side A.
Do you know why that is?
Because it had to end sometime.
I know it goes on and on and on. It goes on a little too long. I think so. I don't know the answer, but I remember hearing a story about John saying to Jeff Emmerich, cut it right there.
Yeah.
And he wanted it cut in a specific spot with some intention, but I don't know what the intention was. But he wanted it just to, stop cold.
Stop right there. Well, it does.
Does it ever?
So, mission accomplished. whatever you set out to achieve, it worked. It just stops. It cuts off. That's fine. It's the end of side A.
That's right.
Side B. Here comes the sun, baby. Here comes the sun.
Do you like it?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you like it? Yeah. You love it.
I love side B. I love side B. This is the album right here. This is
okay.
Here we go. Here comes the sun. It's a really good song. Again, something I've known this song for a long time. It's good. It's flouncy. It's a nice guitar picking pattern. It's
yeah.
I do enjoy it. I do enjoy it.
Yeah.
But it's really saying, like, here comes the bright side of the album is what it's saying.
Maybe. I guess it was written during, like, after a couple of fights, you know, in the studio. And he was Harrison was at Clapton's house, I think, and he wrote it. But just a wonderful song, like really, truly a fantastic song. I do like it. There was a guitar solo, apparently, in this song that got cut in the final mix, and it was lost. And they found it in 2012, believe it or not. Yeah, so his son, I think, and someone else fooled around with it, and it appears somewhere in one of the mixes of the songs.
And then that falls into Because.
What do you think of that one?
It's kind of the beginning of I Want You, She's So Heavy. Same kind of guitar picking pattern there. But it's, you know, it's kind of haunting a little bit, right? Mm-hmm. You know, it's nice. It's good. It's cool. It might be the one song for me that's off on this side. I don't know that it fits very well on this side of the album. Maybe it could have fit on the first side, maybe, but yeah.
I agree with you.
I don't know if it really fits with everything else here.
I think you're right. It would have been, they should have taken Octopus's Garden off and put it in that place.
Yeah.
I'm just kidding. I'm joking.
If you could, I think if there were two you were going to switch, it would be switching those two. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then this is like Because mixed with Eleanor Rigby. That's what this feels like. Because it's like a combo of, She's So Heavy and Eleanor Rigby.
Wow.
I don't know. Maybe I'll mash them together and see what I can do. But
do it.
A little bit. Yeah. You Never Give Me Your Money?
I like this a lot.
I'm just saying, you never give me your money.
Have I not given you money ever?
Never, ever. No, that's fine. Never deserved it. You never give me your money. Good. I like the song.
Yeah. I do too. Classic Paul, right? It's like, you know, it sounds like the Long and Winding Road, like just his piano ballads.
Hmm.
I think it's great.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't, like, you know, people great talk ballad. About this being a ballad, like, I kind of, or not a ballad, a part of the medley, but it always seemed to me to kind of stand apart.
Yeah.
Do you know
I
what I mean?
Like it that, really... I think the medley starts at Sun King, does it not? That's what I felt like. I thought
the medley started, like, right at You Never Give Me Your Money, but I could be wrong. I feel like it does start at Sun King.
Oh, well, I guess at the end of this, it does go into Sun King because it's the crickets, right? So the crickets lead into Sun King as if the sun's coming up. So, like, You Never Give Me Your Money is nighttime, and then it leads into the Sun King.
Right, right.
Kind of interesting that you would kind of talk, like, here comes the Sun King, right? Like, it's kind of like you have Here Comes the Sun, and now you're using the same lyrics, but just adding King at the end of them, right? So,
yeah.
No, who, interesting.
Who knows what was going on?
Yeah, it's a great start to the medley, and then Mr. Mustard is, man, killer.
There's in Sun King. How does that go? At the very end, there's like Spanish or something. Like they kind of meld languages, right? You know, the last lines of the song, like they're speaking Spanish and they use some like Liverpudlian kind of saying chica or whatever it is. And somebody asked John about that. They said, like, what did you do that for? And he said, we're just fooling around. Like we're playing it. And Paul knew a couple words in Spanish from school when we used to go to school. And he started singing them. And so we just were fooling around. But again, you know, like these guys are just goofing off.
Like, that's it, right? Like, can you imagine goofing off and coming up with things, but like to like some of the greatest melodies and instrumentations, right, and compositions ever, right? Right? If you had the ability to create these incredible pieces of music and you've been doing it for so many years, would you not just be trying to find some of like the most fun and ridiculous ways to be like speaking or singing over them?
Yeah, I know.
Because you can't.
I feel like they were at a point where they just said, I don't know. Like, I'm just desensitized now. And I remember thinking about that because George Martin said at one point that medley, like apparently it was McCartney's idea, but Martin said it was my idea because I was trying to get them to start thinking seriously about music again, because they would just like go off and do these, they were just goofing off all the time. Mm-hmm.
It's great. It's great. This whole medley. It's awesome. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, this whole, these, Mean Mr. Mustard and Polythene Pam, like these two songs are back to back great. I mean, this whole side back to back is great, aside from Because, but
yeah.
It's just, it's so good.
See again, Paul, right? Like, or John, rather, Mean Mr. Mustard. Like, mm-hmm. This is what a great, like, that walk up and walk back down. Mm. This was written too. This was supposed to be on the White Album, apparently, but they couldn't really. John couldn't figure it out. If you listen to the Escher sessions, right, the White Album demos that were recorded at Harrison's house, this is on there.
Oh, interesting.
But it doesn't have that, you know, the the walk up and then the walk back down. Mm. It's not in there. So they were just kind of fooling around with the song at the time, and then I guess Lennon figured it out. But wow, like what a composition. And this is just, again, he said, this is junk. He said, this is just a piece of something that I was fooling around with. This is such a good song.
In comparison to where he would take music, right, and to where he would go. And I guess when you look at it back that way, right, like, to see where he would go in terms of playing, the type of music he would play, the type of music he and Yoko would write, and the type of movements they would be a part of. Mm. I mean, you can't help but believe, like, yeah, like something like Me, Mr. Mustard, is that really what he wanted to be doing? Is that really a song that he wanted to be writing? Right.
True. So that's true. That is true. Yeah. When you think about songs like Imagine.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a good point. Yeah. And it's just a cast off. It's just a joke, right? And the lyrics, you know, always shouts out something obscene. What a dirty old man.
Yeah.
That's so funny, right? Take him out to see the queen. Always should have said something obscene.
So I guess these are more. So Polythene Pam be a Lennon song too. Mm-hmm. Then he sings it. Okay. Well, I'm starting to be proven wrong.
I think they did that on purpose.
This really isn't much of a Paul album, right?
No.
I think this is where it is. This is what we're talking about.
Yeah.
We're coming around full circle here, folks.
Yeah.
I guess when I think just about the way that the back half of this is composed, it just feels like something Paul would do. Whether they're Lennon songs. It just feels like a Paul thing to do. But
apparently it was his idea, the medley was.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah, Polythene Pam apparently was about a woman that he met in the U.S. somewhere who was, you know, an enthusiast.
Polyamorous?
Yeah. So, well, she actually wore polythene, and he called her, you know, like, you know, in Liverpool, they had names for women who, you know, had less than savory virtues. And, you know, one of the names was a scrubber, right? So they said she was a scrubber with, who wore jack boots and a kilt.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that was Polythene Pam. She's a real person, apparently.
Oh.
Apparently.
Should sue for defamation. She could have made a killing. Kind of like what? Chuck Berry tried to sue.
That's right.
Came after John Lennon for Come Together.
That's right. Here Come All Flat Top. Hmm. That was a line from one of his songs, I believe.
Yeah. She came into the bathroom window. This is a great transition from that into this. It's perfect.
It is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who do you think says that? Oh, look out.
Lennon?
I thought it was McCartney, but I think it is Lennon.
Oh.
I looked it up. I always thought that was Paul McCartney. Whoa, look out. But I think that it's, in the book that I looked in, it said it was Lennon.
Yeah.
But it sounds to me like it's Paul McCartney.
Oh, the book's wrong. I mean, I'm right. So it's Lennon. Yeah.
There you go. The book is wrong and you're right.
Book's wrong. I'm right. Yeah.
You're the authority.
We have a YouTube show. So
that's right.
Of course, exactly. I'm the authority.
That's right. You're the
I'm just wouldn't read a book on this stuff, Brent. Come in here for it. Okay? Sorry.
Who needs books? What do you need books for?
Here. Okay, but Golden Slumbers is like life changing.
Oh, really? Eh?
Right?
You like is that song?
Not? Oh, it's Cat.
Yeah.
I mean, of course. Yeah.
No,
do you not?
I really do. Yeah.
Yeah. It's incredible.
And that vocal that he like hardens and strengthens in that one passage, right? Because it's very like genteel. And then he just sings the crap out of it.
Gives it.
Like, it's so good. See, again, is the genius behind Paul McCartney, because he sensed that it was a little too gentle. And he had this juxtaposition of like a really kind of aggressive vocal. And it worked.
It's beautiful. It's an incredible song. It's an incredible song. And it's because of how he moves his voice like that.
Mm-hmm.
And mixed with the melody of it. It's incredible. And this and to carry that weight, like it's, man, like.
Oh, yeah.
It's kind of crazy. Like when I would listen to the song, you know, on Apple, right? It's like I wasn't looking at them at the time. Of when they would go through each song. Mm-hmm. So I kind of thought that they were one song. And then so this is the other thing. I didn't realize this whole back half of the album before listening to it was a medley.
Okay.
So when I got into it, I started listening to it. I was like, my God, this is a medley. This is incredible. All these songs fit together. It's the whole back half of the album. This caught me off guard.
Mm.
So so heavily. And was such a pleasant surprise to hear it. And then started reading up about it, and everybody was like, oh, it's the medley, it's a great medley. Blah, blah, blah. I was like, good, good. People appreciate the fact that this is, you know, a cool combination. So it's great.
And what a variance, like what an amazing assortment of like melodic compositions, right? When you go through Mustard and Pam and Carry That Weight and Golden Slumber, like it's just like, different song types, different tempos, different melodies, but the richness of it is just incredible.
It's great. These are the moments of the album that I love the most, from Sun King to the end.
I think that I don't know if anybody knew this, but it was almost like kind of a self-fulfilling prophecy, right? That this would be like the proper end,
right?
You know? And what's that line in the end? The love you take is equal to the love you make, right? Like it just so perfectly summed up the Beatles, and who they were and what they did.
Yeah.
You know, it was just the perfect ending.
And in the end, the love you take is equal to the love you make. You remember that?
Yes.
Is that true?
Yes, Chris, in my experience it is, I find the more you give, the more you get.
Her Majesty is a cool story.
Yeah, what is this one?
So this was just one day at the studio before everybody got there, McCartney just literally turned to hit record and played this little bit, Her Majesty, right? He was just noodling, just the same way that he did Honey Pie, just fooling around. It was originally between Mean Mr. Mustard and Polythene Pam. Because if you listen to the very beginning of Her Majesty, you can hear the last chord of Mean Mr. Mustard. And the last note, you know how it doesn't resolve? It's supposed to resolve on a certain note? It's missing. That note is inside Polythene Pam. So if you go back and listen to that, Her Majesty fits right inside those two songs. Now, The story behind that is that it was originally in there. McCartney listened to the playback and said, I don't like that. It doesn't work. So let's just cut that bit and throw it out. However, George Martin was in, he told it yes and said, no, we don't throw anything away. He kept it aside. And the story goes that after McCartney left, they put it on the record, but they put a time gap there so that it would become almost like a hidden track kind of thing, right? A novelty. And then after, he showed it to Paul and said, what do you think of this? And Paul said, oh, that's kind of cool. We'll leave it like that then.
Yeah, that's kind of cool.
Mm-hmm.
Just making music. A ton of songs. A ton of great songs. These guys. Jerks. You know? Just jerks. Just so good at making music.
And that's the Beatles.
Yeah, I'm like, I don't want to say like addicted's a strong word, but like I'm pretty well like I'm sucked in. I've been sucked into the Beatles. I kind of almost need to like know everything about the Beatles now. You know,
wow.
I feel like I had to go back and listen to things and re-listen to things. And I know I said some songs aren't here aren't great. This might be. It gets really good that back half, but I don't. Mm-hmm. I don't know how I feel fully about this album. I'm like at a 4.5. I think this is like really? Maybe my least favorite so far.
No I feel like, way. What?
Yeah. I know. And I love this back half. I love it. I love this back half. I know. I knew that was gonna.
I don't get it.
Yeah. I mean, it's
wow.
It's a great album, but I just feel like there's some songs on here and there are just some still elements that I need to still get a little bit older for that don't allow me to like appreciate it, I think, yet as much as I will down the road or just at this moment, you know. So
wow. I want to do a yearly check-in, if not a six-month check-in.
Sure.
I want you to listen to I Want You, She's So Heavy every 6 months or a year, and I want to talk about it.
Yeah, that's fair. I wasn't I wasn't as excited about this one as I was when I got into Revolver or even with Sgt. Pepper's and the White Album. Like, wow. Like I wasn't as excited until I got to the second half of this record. And
I wonder
Abbey Road right now.
I wonder if it was reverse nostalgic equity. I wonder if you'd heard Come Together and something and you just kind of had you're imprinted with something and it kind of deterred you from.
I think this may have been sort of a part, you know, I talked about not liking the Beatles beforehand. I feel like there are a number of songs here that were just remind me a little bit maybe why I didn't. Hmm. And I think it's something it's I Want You, She's So Heavy. It might be it's Maxwell Silverhammer, which again I find funny and kind of appreciate more now, but mm-hmm. It was these types of songs that I was associating with the Beatles that I was like, just not into it. So I think look, again, I just told you like I don't want to use the word addicted, but I wanna get into everything about the Beatles. This is not I'm not saying that what they made here is garbage. I'm just saying that I'm not getting into them the way that a lot of people do. Maybe yet, but some of the other albums I liked more than this one, and that's where I am right now. But I'll keep listening. I'm gonna go back and listen even further back. I'm gonna listen to outtakes. I'm gonna go look and watch videos and movies. Like that's how I feel about the Beatles right now. So
perfect.
It's like that. At least it's done that, right?
Oh God, yeah. That's more than that's.
It's pretty good.
Think about, and I can't remember which episode now. I want to go back and watch it. It was in the first maybe five episodes we had done on the show. And I made a comment about the Beatles and you were like, oh, I hate the Beatles. And I said, not for long. No, I didn't. Yeah. I didn't know if you're ever going to like them or not. I don't remember. I think we talked about it and And I just kind of was thinking like, let's see what happens. Yeah.
No, I knew it would come around. I'm glad it did.
Mm.
I'm glad it did. Yeah.
Me too.
I'm into the Beatles. I'm into them.
Nice.
I'm a Paul McCartney fan. Yeah. I think I'm a Paul McCartney fan.
Love it. That bodes well for our next selection then.
Okay. All right. Bad Finger.
Come and get it.
Come get it.
No. Okay.
All right. Before next. There
before
we go.
I announce it. So that concludes our Beatles run, if you want it to. I just want to touch on some of the other records now. So like we didn't do Rubber Soul. That's a pretty important one.
Yeah.
We didn't do like Hard Day's Night and stuff like that. But I think we really kind of got what we wanted out of the Beatles excursion. If you know anything about the catalog, I think we touched on
four albums.
Yeah. We covered the thing is like, again, I always talk about like that period between 63 and 70. Right.
Yeah.
And there were kind of highlights and like, those are the ones that I really wanted to pick out. And I think that, you know, they tell enough of the story without you. I mean, you could go to like Meet the Beatles, like the early records and like, you know, all the please me and love me do's and all that stuff. But
yeah,
I don't think you'd like that very much.
It's all pretty indicative of the music that was coming out at the time, right? It wasn't super different than like what you're getting, like, you know, what they grew into.
Right. It wasn't until, you know, like Beatles for Sale and Rubber Soul that things really changed. And they started to kind of go off into a different area. Yeah. And break away from everybody else. I mean, they were the Beatles, but like they were really the Beatles after that.
Okay.
So, thank you for indulging me. I really enjoyed that little,
thought that was amazing. That was great.
Yeah. That was a lot of fun.
Thanks.
I love, love, love that band.
Yeah.
Okay. So now, let's do Paul McCartney solo. Let's do Band on the Run. Paul McCartney and Wings.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Wings.
Yeah, let's do that.
Cool. Love it. I'm going to do it.
And then after that, we will do John Lennon, Imagine. How about that?
There we go. Let's do it. Great. You now have a sneak peek 2 weeks, 2 weeks ahead here, folks.
We're going to be
doing Paul McCartney, Band on the Run.
Yeah.
And John Lennon's Imagine. Great.
All right. Wow.
Wow. You got Beatles books? You got some Beatles books? I can come over there and still.
I have a lot of Beatles books.
Okay. All right. Well, hey, think about the one that you're going to give me then to get started on knowing the Beatles, okay? Not that I need to give you more work to do, but when I come over there, I'm going to snag one. Make sure you have one ready for me.
All right.
All right. Great. Done. Hey, cheers, everyone, to the Beatles.
Hey, man.
I've heard them, and I'll hear more. Here we go.
Yeah. No, I feel like we've hit a milestone. This is great.
That's great. Feel good. Okay, dude.
All right.
Cheers. Please don't.